Thanks for joining us for another edition of Alaska Weather Facts. I'm meteorologist Dave Snider, and joining us today is Eric Stevens from GINA, the Geographic Information Network of Alaska at the University of Alaska Fairbanks. Thank you for joining us, Eric.
My pleasure, Dave.
Thank you. And you're joining us here to talk a little bit more about satellites and how satellites work, and especially one neat feature that's working over Alaska right now. What is that?
Well, there's a lot of weather satellites and a lot of instruments on these satellites, and there are new generations going up and new instruments. This includes something called the day-night band, which is not a cover band at the local bar, but it's a new satellite that is very useful, especially here in Alaska, especially in the winter.
In the wintertime, that makes it a little bit hard to use some of the normal tools that we associate with weather satellite imagery.
Right. You know, one of the classic weather satellite instruments is just visible light. What would the human eye see? If you were riding on a weather satellite yourself and looked down, and it was black and white, you'd see the clouds reflecting the sunlight. And we've got an example from the Pacific Ocean. There's a geostationary satellite, and we can see that the eastern side of the image is in daylight. The western side, it's night over there, so you don't see anything because there's no sunlight over there. And visible imagery, it's very intuitive. You see the clouds just like you see them standing on the ground, but now you're a satellite seeing them from above. But the problem is, what about the night side of the planet? How do you track the storms? How do you know where the rain is, the snow, the weather, if you can't see the clouds? And that's why, just like a television can change from one channel to another, or a radio can change stations, satellites can change the frequency of the electromagnetic spectrum that they're looking at. We can go to infrared instead of visible light. You know, it's heat energy. You can see heat, and we've got another satellite picture from the same time, same satellite, out over the Pacific Ocean. That's the infrared side, and we're seeing temperature there. And even at night, when there's no light, everything still has a temperature.
So we're sensing something with a thermometer instead of perhaps the visible side of that, is what you're saying.
That's right. Okay. On this depiction, colder features are lighter shades, warmer features are dark. And so clouds tend to be colder than the ground. Clouds are higher in the atmosphere, it's cooler.
Oh, okay.
And so that very same image on the western, or the left-hand side of the globe, now we can see the clouds there, even though it's nighttime, because we're seeing the temperatures. And one nice feature is that tropical storm there, just in the middle of the northern hemisphere there, hurricane or typhoon.
That's that swirly part that we see in the middle of the image?
There you go. You can even see the eye on it there, especially in the infrared image. So, we've got two kinds of imagery there from the same satellite, different instruments, you know, different channels, like on a television, visible and infrared. You know, it turns out there's no one magic tool. Each has its strengths, each has its flaws, weaknesses. The visible is nice, it's intuitive, it's easier to understand, but doesn't work at night.
Okay.
Infrared is nice, it works at night, you can see temperatures, but there is a catch. What if your clouds and the nearby bare ground or open water, what if those were about the same temperature?
Oh, that's going to be hard to figure out what's going on.
If you can only see temperature and you have two features that are the same temperature, they will look the same. You won't be able to tell. They're camouflaged. This happens, especially, it can happen around Alaska, especially over the ocean when you have low clouds that are the same temperature as the open water.
It happens quite a bit in Alaska. Yeah.
We have an example. Now, this is from a different geostationary satellite. It's down over the Atlantic Ocean. Look in the South Atlantic. In infrared, we've highlighted in a yellow circle there, there's some patches of clouds, but it looks like there's a clear area in the middle of that image.
Sure. Yep.
That's the infrared look. But let's take a look at the visible channel, and we can see there's a stripe of clouds across the middle of that circle that is only visible in the visible.
Okay, right.
The trick here is that those are low clouds of about the same temperature as the surrounding ocean. So from an infrared point of view, where you're seeing temperature, the clouds in the water nearby are the same temperature, they look the same. It's only on the visible that you can see what stands out as the actual imagery.
Okay.
Two tools, each have their strengths and weaknesses. Can we combine them? That's where the day-night band comes in.
Oh, okay.
It's a super sensitive visible sensor that can actually see by moonlight. It can even see the aurora.
Wow.
And in Alaska, we have long winter nights. We can use that day-night band. Here's an example from that storm that blew the Kulik drilling platform ashore near Kodiak Island in December. Back in 2012, this image is right near when that storm happened, and it's in the middle of the night in December.
Now this looks like visible imagery.
Looks like daytime imagery. It's amazing. That sensor can take any little bit of moonlight and just make the most of it, and we can see so much detail. Even in the northern part of the image there, you can see some aurora up there. The Northern Lights.
That's that band that goes across the Arctic slope.
You got it. That's the Northern Lights. We're seeing black and white image here, so you don't get the green or the purple colors there. But that is the aurora. There's another example of the day-night band, and this is from January of 2013. It's about 4 in the morning, and this is a snapshot from Weather Service software. And we can even see in the middle of the image, there's the lights of Fairbanks and North Pole over to Eielson Air Force Base. Anchorage and Matsu lights, city lights, are evident as well.
Sure enough.
We can see, even though it's 4 in the morning in January, there is no sunlight to be had, that just enough moonlight is available that this sensor can see that. So we're trying to solve that puzzle where visible light is good, but only during the daytime. IR is good at night, but you can't see the difference between clouds and ground sometime.
Right.
The day-night band is an attempt to do the best of both with one tool. And it's brand new for Alaska here, and we're hoping to use it in the forecast process and help predict storms, weather patterns, to help get good forecast for people.
Okay, another tool in the weather toolkit for meteorologists in Alaska and researchers worldwide. Thank you so much, Eric, for joining us today. And you can learn more about GINA and the day-night band by going to the web address that you see on your screen. For Alaska Weather Facts, I'm meteorologist Dave Snider.